Susie.
Who is at the door, please?
Me.
Oh, this is wild. Come in. I was just going to drop in your room to speak to you about something.
Yeah? What about?
Mrs. Wire, I'm sorry to say, I just don't consider these cockroaches to be the most desirable roommates, do you?
Cockroaches, huh?
Yes, precisely. Now, I have had very little experience with cockroaches in my life before, but the few that I have seen have been the pedestrian kind. These, Mrs. Wire, appear to be flying cockroaches. I was shocked. In fact, I was literally stunned when one of them took off the floor and started to whiz through the air around and around in a circle just missing my face by barely a couple of inches. This is why I sat down on the edge of this bed and wept. I was just so shocked and disgusted. Imagine flying cockroaches! Something I'd never dreamed to be in existence, whizzing around and around and around in front of my face. Why, Mrs. Wire, I want you to know...
Flying cockroaches are nothing to be surprised at. They have them all over. Even uptown they have them. But that ain't what I wanted to...
May be true, Mrs. Wire, but I may as well tell you, I have a horror of roaches. Even the plain, old-fashioned pedestrian kind. And as for this type that flies, if I'm going to stay on here, these cockroaches have got to be gotten rid of, and gotten rid of at once.
Now, how am I going to stop them flying cockroaches from coming into the windows? But that, however, is not...
I don't know how, but there certainly must be a method. All I know is, if I'm going to stay on here, these cockroaches have got to be... If I woke up in the night and found one on my bed, I'd have a convulsion. I simply swear to goodness, I'd die of convulsions.
If you'll excuse me for saying so, Mrs. Hardshell Moore, I think you're much more likely to die from over-drinking than cockroach convulsions. What's this here? Larkspur Lotion.
I use it to take the old polish off my nails.
Very fastidious, yes.
What do you mean?
There ain't an old house in the quarter that don't have roaches.
But not in such enormous quantities, too. I tell you, this place is actually crawling with them.
It ain't as bad as all that. And, by the way, you ain't yet paid me the rest of this week's rent. Oh. I don't want to get you off the subject of roaches, but nevertheless, I want to collect that money.
I'll pay you the rest of the rent as soon as you've exterminated these roaches.
You'll pay me the rent right away or get out.
I intend to get out, unless these roaches get out.
Then get out then and quit just talking about it.
You must be out of your mind. I can't get out right now.
Then what did you mean about roaches?
I meant what I said. They are not, in my opinion, the most desirable roommates.
Okay, then don't roam with them. Pack your stuff and move where they don't have roaches.
You mean you insist upon having roaches?
No, I mean I insist upon having the rent you owe me.
Oh, right at the moment, that is out of the question. And I'll tell you why. The quarterly payments I received from the man who's taking care of the rubber plantation have not been forwarded yet. I've been expecting them for several weeks now, and in the letter that I received this morning, it seems there's some little misunderstanding about last year's taxes.
Oh, now stop it! I've heard enough of that goddamn rubber plantation. The Brazilian rubber plantation. You think I've been in this business 17 years without learning nothing about your kind of women?
What is the implication in that remark?
I suppose the men you have in here nights come in to discuss the Brazilian rubber plantation?
You must be crazy to say such a thing as that.
I hear what I hear, and I know.
And spy. I know you spy, and I know you listen at doors.
I never spy, and I never listen at doors. The first thing a landlady in the French Quarter learns is not to see and not to hear, but only to collect your money. As long as that comes in, okay, I'm blind, I'm deaf, I'm dumb, but soon as it stops, I recover my hearing, and also my sight, and also the use of my voice. If necessary, I go to the phone and call up the chief of police, who happens to be an in-law of my sister's. I heard last night that argument over money.
What argument? What money?
He shouted so loud I had to shut the front window to keep the noise from carrying out on the streets. I heard no mention of any Brazilian plantation, but plenty of other things are plainly referred to in that little midnight conversation you had. Larkspur Lotion to take the polish off nails. Am I in my infancy? Am I? That's right on a par with the wonderful Brazilian rubber plantation.
Stop!
Ugh, it's you.
Stop persecuting this woman.
The second Mr. Shakespeare enters the scene.
I heard your howling in my sleep.
Sleep? Oh. I think that what you mean is your drunken stupor.
I rest because of my illness. Have I no right?
Illness? Alcoholic. Don't try to pull that beautiful wool over my eyes. I'm glad you come in now. Now, I repeat for your benefit what I just said to this woman. I'm done with deadbeats. Now, is that plain to you? Completely fed up with all you quarter rats, half-breeds, drunkards, degenerates who try to get by on promises, lies, delusions.
Please. Please. Stop shrieking. It's not necessary.
You with your Brazilian rubber plantation. That coat of arms on the wall that you got from the junk shop? The woman who sold it told me, one of the Habsburgs.
Stop.
Yes, a titled lady. The Lady of Larkspur Lotion, there's your title.
Stop badgering this unfortunate little woman. Is there no mercy left in the world? What has become of compassion and understanding? Where have they all gone to? Where's God? Oh, where's Christ? What if there is no Brazilian rubber plantation?
I tell you, there is. There is.
What if there is no Brazilian king in her life? There ought to be rubber kings in her life. Is she to be blamed because it's necessary for her to compensate for the cruel deficiencies of reality by the exercise of a little, what shall I say, some God-given imagination?
No. No, no, it isn't imagination.
I'll ask you to please stop spitting me in the face those high-flown speeches. You with your 780-page masterpiece. Right on a par with the Lady of Larkspur Lotion as far as the use of imagination's concerned.
Well, now. What if I am? Suppose there is no 780-page masterpiece in existence. Supposing there is in existence no masterpiece whatsoever. But a few. What of that, Mrs. Wire? What? But a few vain scribblings in my old trunk bottom. Supposing I wanted to be a great artist, but lacked the force and the power. Suppose my books fell short of the final chapter. Suppose the curtain of my exalted fancy rose on magnificent dramas, but the house lights darkened before the curtain fell. Suppose all these unfortunate things are true. And suppose that I, stumbling from bar to bar, from drink to drink, till I sprawl at last on the lice-infested mattress of this brothel. Suppose that I, to make this nightmare bearable for as long as I must, continue to be the helpless protagonist of it. Suppose I ornament, illuminate it, glorify it with dreams and fictions and fancies, such as this 780-page masterpiece, impending Broadway productions, marvelous volumes of verse in the hands of publishers only waiting to be released. Suppose I live in this more pitiful world of fiction. What satisfaction can it give you, good woman? To tear it to pieces? To crush it? To call it a lie? I'll tell you this. Now listen! There are no lies but the lies that are stuffed in the mouth by a hard knuckle hand of need. The cold iron fist of necessity, Mrs. Wire. So I am a liar, yes. But your world is built on a lie. Your world is a hideous fabrication of lies. Lies! Lies! Oh, now I'm tired. And I've said my say. And I have no money to give you. So you get away, and you leave this woman in peace. You leave her alone. Well, go on! Get out! Get away!
Tomorrow morning, money, or out you go! Both of you, both together! 780-page masterpiece and Brazilian rubber plantation! Baloney!
Cockroaches everywhere. Walls, ceiling, floors. Places infested with them.
I know. I suppose the Brazilian rubber plantation didn't have any roaches.
No, of course there weren't. The place was immaculate, always. Floors bright, clean, they used to shine like mirrors.
I know. And the windows, I suppose, they commanded a very lovely view.
Indescribably lovely.
How far was it from the Mediterranean?
The Mediterranean? A mile or two?
On a very clear morning, I dare say it was possible to distinguish the white chalk cliffs of Dover across the channel.
Yes. In very clear weather it was. Oh, thank you, Mr.
Chekhov. Anton Pavlovich Chekhov.
Thank you, Mr. Chekhov.
Thank you.